one, there was a public lecture co-sponsored by our school and UCLA tomorrow evening at UCLA, quite a large hall at 8 o'clock. I was just getting there a little early, even though it is a large hall. But today's format is hopefully a simpler one, and maybe not so lengthy. It has to do with probably some opening remarks, but then a lot of questions that you would have on your mind about this gentleman's work. His work has been an inspiration to my work. And I will describe one project which you probably won't show tomorrow night. In fact, there were two early projects that were both inspirations. One was a small store which you might show. The most inspirational part of that to us when we were first starting out was the fact was its design, certainly. But it also won some enormous prize, which I don't think they give anymore. And so we started designing stores. We had a chance to do that. And stores out of aluminum is a key thing. The space, though, that I'd like to describe is a rather simple one. And I think for me, it was one of the first, being a kind of dunce at that time, maybe there were many things before, but I don't think so. One of the first, brilliantly conceptual but also perceptual projects that came on the scene. And it was a very simple task. It makes probably a lot of stuff. Maybe it wasn't even your project display paper. Put paper on exhibition. I think it was a long, narrow space of some sort. The solution was, let's put a piece of glass down the space at a slight angle from sort of floor to ceiling, a single piece of glass. Now that we have the space divided into two parts, then everything else follows. A piece of wood in the form of a tree trunk comes and is sliced off by the piece of glass, and on the other side, a pile of sawdust. On one side of the piece of glass is a piece of marble with the equipment necessary to write out a few words. And on the other side, there are reams of paper typing on them. And then I remember the most beautiful part was a little podium with a glass box on top. And inside was a crumpled up piece of paper. Did I get one there? Yeah. So bring you Hans Holbein.
Possibilities which I think will interest you as students who we'll have to start with a very small little project that I think in my development that the initial chances I had to do things were on an extremely small scale, and rather than looking down upon this relatively minor opportunity, the store that Manjurin mentioned was about 140 square feet. I decided at a very early point working on this that I wanted to make an architectural statement, even if this is on an extreme small scale, and even if this is with a very small budget. And a lot of the other things I have done subsequently, they're very small projects, but on each project I tried to demonstrate certain aspects of my thinking, and sometimes it was very good that you had to you have been forced to sort of utter yourself somewhere in a nutshell and make a specific, very condensed statement with rather limited possibilities. And only later on I progressed to bigger structures where I was able to sort of make a synthesis of the things I have been thinking about, I have been trying to forward, and which in the smaller projects only could be shown in certain sectors and in certain aspects. This doesn't mean that on my early projects I think they're incomplete, or that I have made a too limited the statement, but they have been statements with each time a different emphasis, and the bigger the project became, the more complex I tried to make the statement. Maybe it's interesting for you, and you will see tomorrow in the lecture. It's difficult to sort of give a lecture twice, and so certain things I would rather say tomorrow than today. That I'm working in a variety of related fields to architecture. That I do interiors, I do furniture, I do product design, we design coffee makers, or we design door handles, and we design expensive jewelry, or I design watches. I have always been very interested in areas which are not usually have not been considered the center of the activity of an architect. Although the view has changed a little, I remember when I gave some talks some years ago in the United States, my friend Richard Meyer said, "Hans, you shouldn't show so many interiors and furniture and tableware, and this is not good for an architect. An architect doesn't do such things. Better for his reputation." Now it's exactly the things they're doing right now. And so I do these things, or I do stage sets, and I do a lot of exhibitions, both the thematical exhibitions, sometimes on a very large scale, which and making the exhibitions doesn't mean that I just sort of design them, but I also develop the concept. One of the more important exhibitions which also had been done in this country, is the opening exhibition of the Cooper Wood Museum in New York on the topic of design, design in the most general sense. Another area of my activity, always from the beginning of my student days on, had been the fine arts and have been a worker artist. At a certain period, paintings, but mostly in the way of installations. Environments which I have been doing for many years. So to my way of thinking, to the way I work, and you may talk much more about it when you can ask questions, it is very important that I do these different things, because to me, one fosters the other. One activity is an impetus to come to new approaches in the other areas, which I think they are related, and it's a sort of sliding border, and not a clear-cut division between these areas. But this, of course, brings with it, and this is my way of working, that I do not have a very, at least by American standards, a very big office, because I like to do things myself. It is the reason why I became an architect, not to be a manager of a big corporation of 100 to 150 people, but be involved in every aspect of the design of the project, on my office, my studio, and I have a studio of about 18 people, and with this we do the work we are doing. And we only do work wanted to. And for a time this has been very difficult, because I didn't have very much work, but I did only work I could agree with, and I could be responsible for. So I think we maybe start this with some of the informal chat. And if you have more specific questions tomorrow after the lecture, you, of course, are welcome to ask them tomorrow. I don't know how familiar you are with part of my work. You are the moderator.
Is there anyone who has questions? Other than people who want to work for Ms. Olin. No questions? Yes?
I have a question. How do you like your countrymen or the work of your countrymen, Wolf Creek? How do you like the work of Wolf Creek, your fellow?
Wolfgang Creek? Well, I like it, yeah.
Good.
Besides my other activities, for 7 years, an editor of a magazine years ago, and I published the first work of Hilary Lau.
Let me broaden that question. Is it fair to say, I'm not a student of the architecture that comes out of Austria, but is it fair to say that there are two very divergent thrusts to the work of Kupfenbau and a number of other groups doing work that is of, let's say, on the borderline of
Kobe could possibly imagine. And another group is doing work which is much more, now I'm going to probably get myself into trouble, along the lines of the sort of more rational or even alluding to Love's, thinking of a good friend, Mark Madden, practicing Austria.
And you think he's more on the line of Love's? Well, I know Mark very well. He worked in my studio for some time. I mean, at least with these examples you give, I wouldn't see that a very strong difference in the approaches by these people. I think they are, of course, different approaches by different groups in Austria. I think that the sort of the local influences, especially the influences of the historical figures like Wagner or Loos or Hoffmann, they have been on all of them in a rather diverse way, of course. And for instance, to me, the writings of Loos at the beginning were much more important than buildings, even though of course he studied the buildings and probably are influenced by them, which you can't escape if you are sort of part of a local scene. Also in the work of Himmelblau, I think it's you cannot separate things so easily.
Back there.
I was wondering what tradition you sort of see yourself part of, or to ask another way, who do you consider to be major influences on your work, or whose work, in the past or when you were younger, were you most interested in? Do you see yourself as doing that?
I personally don't see myself coming out of a very specific school or a very specific heritage. Of course, part of my past is, of course, Vienna, and as I just said, it's difficult to escape the developments of the local scene. It's difficult. Even though when I studied, we didn't learn about Loos, Hoffmann, or Wagner. There was no talk about them, no publications about them. Josef Hoffmann was still alive and was sitting in the coffee house and had no job. And some of us young students were just walking up to him and talk to him, and very happy that he talks to us, and he was very happy that somebody talked to him and knew about his work. Because at that period, the work of this architect, but also the work of instance, people like Klimt or Schiele was not valued at all. And I was a student who could buy a Schiele drawing for $10. Now you have to pay $7 million for a Schiele. In a way, a very limited group of, limited in number of students tried to recover our past in terms of the early modern, and so we got, in a way, by digging up this past, we got very familiar, of course, with the work of these people, and we didn't dig it up specifically to become very close followers of Loos or Wagner or someone, but because we just wanted to to know what has happened there. But of course it rubs off. To me, at the very early point, I wanted to get out of Vienna because I found, at that time, I think the situation has changed, I found the situation rather ferocious and provincial. Even though you had sort of the memories of the past, the period of the past. And I left for Sweden and the United States. I don't think, I have confronted myself with the work of a lot of architects, of course, and studied it intimately, but I think to me the influence was, for instance, America was much more America itself, the lifestyle, and above all the landscape. I was extremely impressed by the landscape here, the vastness, the dimensions. I drove about 60,000 miles through America on my first visit. Just because I wanted to get to know the country, but also to, for instance, I once drove from New York to Los Angeles as fast as I could, just to experience distance. Or I went to see all the Viennas in America, Vienna, Virginia, Vienna, Illinois, about five or six. And so, I also, for instance, looked at all the buildings by Frank Lloyd Wright. I think I have, except Falling Water, which I was not admitted to at that time. Edgar Kaufman didn't let me. In the meantime, you can. And I never made it back there. I have seen even the pigsties he did in Alabama. And this I did because I came to, when I came to the United States, I came to Chicago. And I studied for a year at IIT. Which I left because there was too much Prussian dogmatism. And I was invited by Frank Lloyd Wright to visit him at Taliesin. And I was extremely impressed by him and his work, which I was not when I had seen it before in photographs. So this was a very good lesson for me that you shouldn't trust photographs. And this was the point because then I said, okay, I look at the work of one person very closely and in reality, not in the books. And I had the good fortune to meet also the creator of this work, in person. So, look at the picture. So, certainly there were influences on this side. I went, part of the reason to go to Chicago was Mies van der Rohe, which was whose work I liked. Maybe not so much his teaching method, but because I saw here a tendency for an absolute architecture. And at that time I was looking for an absolute architecture to get a definition of what architecture is. And I tried to do architecture which is useless, because I thought when I go to get to a point where architecture becomes useless without purpose, but it's still architecture, then I have found a definition of architecture. And architecture which still is architecture, not sculpture. So I tried to make architecture which is a building, which is architecture, and which is not sculpture, but which is it's not derivative from a specific function, analysis of a problem, the analysis of the problem is the solution. Because I do not believe that architecture is the solution of problems. I think architecture is a statement. And I was looking for that, and my concern, my driving for this, what I call absolute, today you could also call it autonomous architecture, something like that, was to get for myself, because it was a strictly personal thing. I wrote about it, but it's basically was strictly for my own coming to an idea to about what architecture is. And if I, in two very short sort of terms, I think architecture on the one side is a ritual thing, and on the other side, I think it's in the definition of McLuhan, it's a means of preservation of body temperature. And I think all architecture has been created within those two poles. And in different periods, civilizations, cultures, you have emphasis on more on this or more on that aspect. The inhabitant of a southly island, he must not concern himself with protecting himself against the elements and the coconuts fall into his lap. So he has time to develop elaborate dances, elaborate rituals, even houses for rituals. While, for instance, the Eskimo, who is to me the designer par excellence, there's no civilization which is so ingenious about doing things like the Eskimo, doing a kayak or a harpoon or snow goggles or what have you. I mean, it's a perfection, or it's in terms of use of material, use of a limited range of material, which is at this people's disposal. You can learn a lot from them. But they, of course, have to spend a lot of energy on developing means of survival and preservation of body temperature. And they cannot come up with big rituals or buildings for rituals. But they strive for survival, and I think human being is always concerned with survival. Survival during life and survival after life. I think the root of architecture is this, that you want to survive after life in terms of building. Well, another question.
Yeah. More questions? More questions? Yes, Michael.
Yeah.
Brief question, perhaps a longer answer. Years ago, you put together a show at the Cooper Hewitt called Man Transforms.
Yeah.
Which in many ways was a very curious show, because everybody expected there to be fine objects, like the Museum of Modern Art might have exhibited. You decided to show something else, and I was wondering if you could explain.
Okay. Well, I just mentioned this show before. You are very right. I exactly did not what the Museum of Modern Art would have done and what many of the people in New York have expected. And after the show, I suddenly was an outcast in New York, and Peter Eisenman and the Institute, they attacked me very strongly for doing such an exhibition. It didn't show beautiful objects and wasn't in architectural terms beautiful arranged. But I wanted to the idea of this show was that the Cooper Hewitt Museum is the Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of Design, and the opening exhibition was supposed to give an idea about design in the broadest sense, from product design via architectural design to urban design. And to show this to a larger audience, and there was a kind of limited competition between Charles Eames and Venturi and Richard Berman and who else? Me? I think George Nelson. I'm missing one. Anyway, finally I was selected to do this show, and they had invited me mostly on the basis of the exhibition I had done at the 1968 Triennale, which had a complete new approach to concept of exhibitions. And also in this New York show, I tried to make clear, show different topics related with the general topic in a way that it would be for visitors, for people of all educational backgrounds, that it should be informative and understandable for the famous man from the street who has a very little previous knowledge and maybe a limited education, and it also should give pleasure and insight and have interest for people who are initiated and very informed and educated. And for instance, I tried to show certain concepts of design. One was the transformation, the metamorphosis of a piece of clothes. And I showed concepts of design. What do you do with a piece of clothes? And what a piece of clothes is something which is first a product of a very specific design process that you come to a piece of clothes by, for instance, weaving it out of simple threads, and then you have this piece of clothes, and then you can make clothing, and you can make clothing in two ways. You take this piece of clothes and wrap it, and you wrap it in very complicated ways, like a sari or a toga or a himachi or whatever. So a lot of cultures do this. They just take a simple piece of clothes and then have a very elaborate way of putting their body into this piece of clothes. And the Western man has a different approach because he did not want the, and actually we made two parallel movies like we have when you have downhill skiing, that you can see the skiers at the same time. So we showed how long it takes you to put on a toga, for instance, and then how long does it take to put on a body-fitting suit, where you have, at one time, you have to spend a lot of time to make a cut, that it's fitting your body, and to fabricate. But once you have done this, dressing yourself each day is a matter of seconds, while dressing yourself in a toga is each day is a long affair. It always falls off, and you have to rewrap yourself. But not only this. So what do you do with a piece of clothes? You make a teepee, or you make a tent, Arab tent, where you have a windmill with powered by sails made of clothes, and you have a boat where a piece of clothes assists the means of transferring one energy into movement, and so or you. You take your handkerchief and you you can do all kinds of things with your handkerchief, as you know, and you can cover your head, and you can, Arab women have to cover their faces, and you can blow your nose, and or you take it and you paint on it, and it becomes very valuable. So the transformation of values, for instance, of material values, was once. You can let your fantasy go on and think about the many different ways of using a piece of clothes, but making use of the properties of the piece of clothes. And some other aspects were, for instance, to show that design, in design, a form does not follow function, not always. But in many instances, form follows different principles. So I collected, for instance, the daily breads of all over the world in a very difficult, very difficult to do that. And all over the world, the daily bread is basically done in the same method. It's, you have flour and water, and you mix it and you bake it. And if form follows function, all the daily breads all over the world should look somewhat alike, which is not true at all, because they look extremely different. Because they are formed after different considerations. Some daily breads are formed after religious symbolisms. Some are formed after sexual symbolism. Some are formed after considerations of storage, like Scandinavian breads. And so you have a variety of reasons to give this daily bread, and then this daily bread has its shape through centuries. You have a variety of reasons that it just has this particular shape. Sometimes you know why, sometimes you just see that it has this strange shape and you don't know why. So we had a big table, and we fashioned this table as it was the same table like in Leonardo's Last Supper. And on this table we spread out this bread. So this was, for instance, very much criticized in New York, that the architect displaced bread and not models. In this series of non-functional products, there's another one, the star. The star is a product of sheer fantasy. I mean, everybody knows that this, how a star looks today, and he knows that the star doesn't look like what you call a star, but interestingly enough, the star-shaped object, which is called stars in almost all cultures, is something you have since early times. So in this show, we showed early scenes of Hammurabi, the star shaped. And it had this shape of a star, like you know, the six-pointed, or seven-pointed, or five-pointed star. And so this is a product of sheer fantasy, certainly slightly maybe derivative from what the radiation, when you look with slightly blurred vision into a star, would look. But so it's a pure invention. It's an object of pure invention, which in U-term became then a pattern. For instance, you have star-shaped
cities, or you have star-shaped motors or things like that. So you the system of the star became a form-generating element or an organizational element. So this was shown, for instance, and by this approach, I think we were able to give people an insight into the design and the design process, and give them an insight on a level where they can easily grasp, and not on a level where you think people are stupid and you have to give them sort of slightly condescendingly explain them that the difficulties of the universe. But it's an approach that they can easily get into the topic and then have their own thoughts and own associations and go on from that. We show things like this, sand and water metaphors, I mean, like that certain cultures substitute sand with water, or vice versa. You know, it's from the rock gardens, or a Muslim, if he has no water, can wash himself in sand. Similarities. And then this went over to showing the concept of island and oasis. Well, island is blue water and yellow island, and oasis is yellow sand and blue water, and blue and yellow mix and generates green. This thing, and they showed this in physical terms. We showed this in very short movies, slightly longer than a commercial, because we thought that we should be able to convey a message very fast, which a commercial can. This was some of the approaches in this show, which did not demonstrate design only in terms of the final product. We showed, of course, the final products, but this was just one part of the task. I think I have basically made the idea clear.
I'm interested in how you describe your exploration of architecture, space, and form. It seems that I don't imagine you describe that as a conscious comment or criticism on culture, but maybe you do. But almost in a daily way, how you approach it, is it more intuitive? More critical? Is it just revealing the world that you see around you? It's part of intuition, then how do you transform that into expression and communication?
Well, this is a lecture by itself. I think they are quantifiable and not quantifiable. Parts of architecture. The non-quantifiable, in my work, derived from intuition. And the quantifiable derived from quantification. Does that answer your question?
Do you pontificate more or less than you intuit?
Huh?
Which do you like to do more, intuit?
Both. I always loved very much mathematics, and the clearness certain approaches where you can say right or wrong. But I also, on the other side, like the unsure and the non-established. And this one I try to solve with intuition. And there are tasks which you can easily solve. To have a good working surface on your drawing table, you can give a certain amount of looks of foot candle, and you know that this is a good lighting, and it doesn't hurt your eyes, and or it doesn't strain your eyes. When you have to design a restaurant, you have all options open. You can make it extremely brilliant lighting, or you can put up a candle per tip. And so it's very difficult here to quantify things. And what makes a space, for instance, what we call in German gemütlich, cozy, agreeable, it gives you a certain atmosphere. This is very difficult to put into figures, schedules, color schemes, and so on. I do this intuitively. Also color, I use intuitively. I mean, I have sort of, behind my intuition, I have certain personal theories, which maybe not very objective. And in teaching, this is, to me, teaching is the interesting part in teaching. And this is why I like to teach the way I teach. I teach at the Academy of Applied Arts in Vienna. And very small numbers. We are a small school, slightly elitist, because we accept only a very limited number of students. And you deal with a limited number of students, and you, to me, in teaching, to talk about and develop in the project of the students, the non-quantifiable is, to me, much more interesting. It's very difficult to convey, because you cannot, as I initially said, you cannot say right or wrong in this. But this is, I think, what then makes a good architect. If it would be just the result of a process of truth or wrong, it would be very simple to train architects and to become one. Well, I would be become another person who creates something, and this, what I initially said, this is maybe the reason why I haven't pigeonholed life and possibilities of life and areas of activity in such a way that you cannot step from the one to the other. If I wouldn't have become an architect, I would have become a sculptor, a painter, maybe not a musician. I love music, but in terms of execution, I'm not so well versed. But it's something where you can create something. This I would do. But you can create also in other areas. Sometimes the process is more manual and more continuous, and sometimes process of creations are sort of condensed in short periods of time. I think you can be creative in a variety of fields. You can also be creative as a physician or as I don't know, as a banker.
Perhaps I could ask you a question. One of the more fascinating examples of your working in scales to me is you did a T-set, which is an aircraft carrier. Is that right? What does it mean when you take something like an aircraft carrier with all of its connotations and turn it into an object of culture and leisure, like a teapot?
Yes, that's a good question. Two aspects. One is an aspect of scale, and another is an aspect of meaning and content. I have always been fascinated by not only the aircraft carrier, but by certain objects, mostly technical objects, and their generative power, and their power of association. And I, for a period in my life, I did what I call transformation, which were collages where I took objects, an Oreg, an aircraft carrier, a tool, what have you, and transformed and transported it in terms of scale and locale. And by this change of scale and locale, certain things happen. For instance, a lot of these montages are in the Museum of Modern Art in New York now. You can see an Oreg, which then became a monument to the victims of the Holocaust, just by transforming this object. I didn't change it, except in scale, and I put it in a certain set. And it had an extreme power of conveying a certain idea, which the original, you have to discover this hidden possibility, but when you discover it, then you can set it free. And the same thing is true for the aircraft carrier. To me, the aircraft carrier did many things. It was, for one, a beautiful object. Of course, you can argue this is an object of war. The walls of Istanbul are also an object of war. The medieval castle was also an object of war. The fortifications of Michelangelo are also an object of war. So there can be content and beauty in war too, and in objects of war. And of course, as a Viennese, you're always dealing with death anyway, and death and blood, very physical. And so to me it was slightly like the power of a medieval armor, which besides its mere function just generates maybe a horrifying picture or maybe a very monumental picture. And so this, to me, the aircraft carrier did. Also did something. I have a belief, for instance, that the cantilever is the, in architecture, is something out, which is very specific for the 20th century. I mean, it started with the 19th century, it's a Firth of Forth Bridge or so, but the famous cornice by Cornacchi on the Palazzo Strozzi was so famous because it can't live it out, I don't know, 3 feet or so. Only in this century we are able to do a big cantilever. So I think this is very important for architecture in this century. The cantilever and the seamless surface. The seamless surface is another product of our century where you really can do a seamless surface. The end of last century, a seamless surface was very difficult to obtain. A monolith was something famous. A monolithic column is something famous. The big vessel in the Temple of Jerusalem was famous because it was one cast big seamless vessel, but it was, I don't know, that big. Water tightness is also the advent of plastic is something which is something of this century. And until then, you were very good if you could make a tight seam. So the cantilever in the aircraft carrier, the asymmetry in a symmetrical object, which always fascinated me, the overlay, and tomorrow in my lecture, we'll see that it happens very often. It's an overlay of symmetry and asymmetry. And this comes back to my belief. I study very much the human body. And if you ask before, what are my influences? I think the biggest influence is the human body. And I'm continuously drawing the human body. Not only because you have to have life drawing classes in your curriculum, but because I think you can learn everything from the human body. And the human body is to me the best example also in terms of architecture, that it's a symmetrical object. But for instance, I sit here completely asymmetrical. Only for certain occasions, if I'm the pharaoh of Egypt, I will sit like this, very symmetrical. Or if I'm a priest, I will make a movement like this. So this is the ritual approach. Symmetry is something which is, and we have a lot of discussion about symmetry in architecture. If symmetry is totalitarian, but there are objects like it is very difficult. There exists some. It's very difficult to do an asymmetrical airplane. And we normally would not want to travel on asymmetrical. And a boat, of course, is a symmetrical object. But the boat, again, early history, like the gondola of Venice, is an asymmetrical object, very ingeniously made slightly asymmetric to perform certain functions. And on a more complex way, the gondola is more unified, the aircraft carrier is more fractioned. The aircraft carrier is the same because you have a basically asymmetric object which then adapts in a non-symmetric way to certain functions. This is another aspect of the aircraft carriers which fascinated me. Another one was that the aircraft carrier is a compact city of 8,500 inhabitants or something like that. I don't know how much the enterprise has, but it's several thousand people. And with a perfect organization. And again, it's sort of very hermetic. And so I transformed this aircraft carrier into a landscape. Around this aircraft carrier was just hills and woods, and the city was, the aircraft carrier city was very compact and didn't spread out. Even though I don't think cities, like Los Angeles, I think spreading out cities can be very beautiful too. But this specific approach interested me, and I didn't belittle the belligerent connotations, but you can sort of also go beyond this sort of more superficial association, and you can penetrate into more complex conclusions. So this is so much to the interest in the aircraft carrier. And the other is the question of scale. And to me, it is fascinating that certain things can change in scale, but still retain their power, so to speak. The power of communication, or the and other things, if you change them in scale, they lose their potency, so to speak. Columns, for instance, can change to a certain degree in scale, and still are the same. And their products, like suspension bridge, the original suspension bridge comes from the Himalayas, and suspended over ravines which are 5 yards the shores apart. And exactly the same system, you just blow up and spend the Golden Gate. It's not different. While, and this is one approach, the Romans had a different approach. The little river, they spend with one arch, and the big river, they spend with 27 arches. So it's one is the change in scale in terms of the same unit, so to speak, is blown up or reduced, and the other approach is to multiply, to add. And again, to come back to this question before about the show in New York, I here also try to show that many design approaches consist of the approach of putting things, putting units together. You will have great difficulty to invent a Martian being. I give this sometimes new students of mine as a sort of test. Invent a Martian being, something which, you know, this usually this little green man who come from somewhere. But all these little green men are additions, things put together of already known features, maybe slightly distorted. But you will have great difficulties. You can go home tonight and try to invent a being which is not reminiscent of anything you have seen before. And all these famous monsters you have, they're either combination of animal and human features, or distortions, or just you have one eye instead of two, or three eyes instead of two, or you a centaur. This is, of course, not horse, but human being, like the sphinxes. So this is one approach, combination. The other is changing the same thing, the same unit changing its scale. So when I did this tea and coffee set, this was certainly a capricious idea. Because it really came from the trade. I was asked to do this coffee set, but also the trade. And so I thought about the shape of the trade. And when I thought about the shape of the trade, and of the trade you have not only the creamer and of course the coffee pot and the sugar bowl that you also have to put on the cups for the coffee. So you have several cups, and then you have single element. So suddenly, to me, the aircraft carrier came to my mind, and I didn't want to make it normal. I wanted to make it slightly non-symmetric. So suddenly, the aircraft carrier, in terms of the coffee set, was here. But, for instance, they're extremely functional. We made about 5 prototypes where we made specific pouring tests that you pour it, that coffee really pours right. And not, it's not a, an object for the showcase, it's an object for use. So this was a very long explanation, but I wanted to explain it a bit long because I understood the sort of the slightly critical question.
At the same time of thought, you mentioned you work on projects that you like to work on. What projects would you not like to
work on? What project do I not
like? Would you not like to work on? Would you turn the client down?
Well, if he asks that I do compromises, or I was 2 weeks ago in Chicago and they showed me a jail and they told me that this architect is a specialist in jail and there's nothing in jail. So I don't know if I would like to do a jail, for instance. So there are certain tasks which I probably would not do, and I just would refuse to do that. I have refused a number of commissions which I couldn't agree with the approach, or I couldn't be personally be sort of have a responsible attitude about that. I mean, there are certain things I do not like to do, I have to do in order to realize the thing I want to do. 90% of realizing a building is 10% is really fun, and 90% is sort of fight and work. You have to push this project through against a lot of difficulties, and this you really don't like to do, but you do because you want the result.
You said a little while ago that architecture is a question of making statements, not of solving problems.
Yeah.
But the 3 of the things that you cited a minute ago, the cantilever and the aircraft carrier and the human body standard, seems to me outgrowths of problem solving. I mean, very developed outgrowths of problem solving. I wonder if maybe I didn't understand the first statement correctly or how you grasped all that.
Well, I mean, this is then the second round very often. You want to make this statement and then you think about what means do I have to make to realize this statement. And then, of course, in the second round, you are piecemeal, you are solving problems. I absolutely agree with that. I mean, this is ours. When I talked before about we make 5 different prototypes to test the pouring of the coffee, this is of course also solving the problem. But first, I think the initial impetus is the statement. You decide to build a pyramid and then you try to solve the problems to build the pyramid. But the pyramid is not the solution of solving the problem of the grave, because the master bar is exactly the as valid as a solution to the problem of burying a mummy than is the pyramid. And a few centuries before the pyramids you had master bars, and a few centuries after the pyramids you had master bars. And at a certain period people just had the idea to build big mountains.
Seems that Vienna has changed very much in the last century.
In the last century, yeah.
So you mentioned certain things about Vienna as you were speaking. Could you talk a little bit about how
think Vienna is a very difficult place to practice architecture and the arts. But in a way, I like this difficulty. I think it's a very creative city, and you have very interesting encounters, which it's a fertile soil in a way. But it's the general climate is rather hostile. So this kind of dualism is very interesting. Maybe very typical for Vienna. The Viennese have a very negative attitude, while here everybody say, oh great what you have done, and they give it a chance, and so on. In Vienna you can do the greatest thing, and they say, wow, this, we'll have to really look at it and consider it, and it's really not so good, and maybe there's somewhere something much better. And so it's this kind of attitude that tries to prevent you to do many things, but if you it also says it's this kind of this force against you. This resistance is something which generates a lot in you. So, otherwise, Vienna is a beautiful city, both physically and also to live in. It's a very comfortable city, a very humane city, it's a safe city, no crime, little crime. Lifestyle is pleasant. Advantages and disadvantages, and I like the personally in a way I like the Viennese this slightly negative mood, or this, as I said before, is the Viennese they think a lot about death, which I think is a very important issue in life. I don't mean it's fun-wise. People today, maybe especially in American society, they start thinking about death, and they are removed from life in the last minute in the hospital. I think death should be present in your life all the time. Well, in a way, it has to have a certain size, necessarily, not only because the human being, which has been now as far as the measure of this thing, it starts with a certain size. I mean, what someone does is not architecture. Sculptures, because it's so. I mean, it's difficult to say from exactly what size of architecture, but certainly you can. There are people who squeeze into little boxes, so maybe their architecture starts size-wise. I think, for instance, that the stores I did, some of them are very small, are architecture. But again, I don't think it's only a question of scale, and I don't think that the relationship I have when I do interiors, when I do design and products, is not question only of different scales. These are related objects, related approaches, are sort of how you arrive at the result. The method, the strategy, they are related. But I don't think especially what my interest in these different fields is it's not the jumping from one scale to the other. Jumping from one sort of outlook to the other, from one area to the other. But it's like what the stage says, it's the same scale as architecture. It's the same scale as architecture, but two very different approaches. And I do a stage set, I approach it differently than architecture. Of course, you have sometimes architectural element in the stage set, or vice versa. Architecture can learn from stage set. The Russian constructivism learned very much from the constructivist stage set. Sometimes you are faster to do a stage set than a building. Or is it in stage set? I had a very interesting experience doing stage set. I did in a stage set, the first act was out of the script, had to be a celebration in the garden. And I conceived a big tent with the whole stage of the Vienna Burgtheater. I put in the tent, it's an enormous stage. And so when I started to do this tent, you have to make a cut to get the tent. And I didn't know how to do the cut, so I called my friend Fryotto and he said, can you tell me what computer program I should take to do a cut for the tent, that it really has this specific curves. And he said, well, you see, there are a lot of programs, but they are not worth nothing. The best thing is you do a full-scale model. So, if you come to your client and say, well, I'm not quite sure about this hall here, can I make a full-scale model? And in order to find out, he would throw you out and say, you're crazy, you're wasting my money. I came to the people in these shops who do the stage sets, and I said, well, my information is that I should make a full-scale model of this tent. And he said, okay, we do it. And they made the full scale model. And we tried out, and when we had it tried out, we made the final product for 50 performances. And I found this great. And I saw how stupid we are. When we do buildings which are for 50 years, for 100 years, we are not investing a single dollar in a mock-up to check certain things which millions of people maybe are confronted every day. through the years. But here, for a stage that you have, there's no problem to do this. So, or in this respect, I think you can learn from stage that. But to come back to your question, so this is just going from one related field to the other, but not a question that I just want to shift in scale. And also I have done other coffee pots, like the filter coffee pot, the mass production, which is not a reduction or blowing up of any existing objects or architecture, but it's just a thing in itself.
How does the notion of the death affect your work?
Of notion of what?
Death.
Death?
Yeah.
It's difficult. It's a subject which is difficult, and it's difficult to sort of pinpoint exactly where it specifically shows. Not necessarily, of course, in the size of the elevators that you can put the coffin into an elevator. Which I think is important, because I think one of the problems today is that people, I think it would be much better for people to die at home than in the hospital, for instance. Our society doesn't provide for this anymore. I mean, it starts with a family who is not prepared to care for a person dying, and down to the problem that you don't know how to remove the body from the apartment. But I think it's just a question of your general philosophy of life, that the notion of death is affecting you. And I would say my general approach to life is in some way mirrored in the results I materialize in my work. Of course, sometimes, especially in the, not so much in the architectural, but more in the artistic utterances of my mind, it is very clearly visible that the confrontation as I also said before, I think also the relationship to blood, which has very close connection with death, of course, is something which shows in my artistic, sometimes extremely camouflaged. I mean, again, it's not a question of the obvious. If you don't mind. Can you speak up a little? I don't understand you. Still living, and they are very pleased with the way the artist
How would you respond to, there's a Dutch architect who called that building a piece of bourgeois consumer show-off. How do you respond when someone says that about your building? Let's say Mönchengladbach. It's a very flashy building, right? There's a lot of architectural elements there.
Well, I don't know what you mean with architectural elements. I think architecture, per definition, is made of a lot of architectural elements. This would be the same problem if you say the human body is made out of certain elements of the human body, and you would attack that. I don't think it's a flashy piece of consumerism. But you can, if you exemplify this a little more in detail, I can answer it a little more in detail. I'm not awaiting these questions, but you will have to come into more specific terms. And in what way is it a type of consumerism or flashy piece of consumerism?
Architect, right? Looked at the building and said that it displayed the architecture came down to lots of very expensive looking objects on display, and too little attention was paid to the actual spaces made or the artworks displayed. There was too much attention on how rich and snazzy, how effective all the materials were.
For instance, what?
The
kinds
of staircases and the marble inlays and the different
lighting
fixtures.
I have no marble inlay in my regard to that. So you must have had the imagination, I have marble floor. And the marble I take because stone is a very good floor for museums. Because I think certain sculptures, for instance, it looks very strange if you have a Sarah, for instance, on the carpet. So I decided to have the stone floors, and we decided to have the marble floor because we wanted a white museum, because we wanted a very neutral background. White walls, white ceilings, white floors. It's a very simple approach, and it leads to white marble. If certain people have a hang-up that white marble is something flashy, that's their problem. To me, white marble, I use building materials for the architectural value and for the functional necessity. And today, for instance, marble is, we have marble quarries in Austria where the marble is more expensive than the marble from the ground. So just shipped, you ship red sandstone from India or granite from Sweden in the empty ships who return from somewhere shipping other goods. So these are cheap building materials today. Or is it gold? Is a cheap building material. Gold plating costs today as much as gold plating. I think you have different backgrounds, so you can give me the instances where you see this flashy in the fabulous.
Well,
no, I think if you make this accusation, you should not avoid the discussion.
Okay. I was quoting someone else who said that. But
okay.
I wanted to bring it up because your architecture often uses materials which seem to delight, as you yourself have said, in their own richness. You use your copper leaf palm trees, you use your dumba, you have a variety of different staircases which seem to delight mainly in counting different ways of to make a staircase turn, go down, and go up again. And there seems to be a lot of delight in the use of all these different materials, and rather than in the making of a specific room.
I think I'm making a very specific room. And I see nothing wrong about denied, so that there is nothing wrong about it if the user has denied. If you name the staircases, I can tell you exactly the philosophy of the staircases. I did not want staircases which are sort of towers where you pile on top of each other flight of stairs. Staircases in Mönchengladbach are heaps, are indentions. Most of the staircases do not have this uncomfortable next flight of stairs above them, so you have three new, which I think is important also psychologically. And the whole idea about the stairs is the main idea is psychologically. We have to cover in height in this museum about 24 meters, which is 75 feet. And I want the people to go from the lowest floor to the top floor and down again without any feeling spaces, which he very often is not equipped to do. Here, the work of art, which is mobile by its general tendency, will find its place. Of course, this you can more easily do with a modern museum than you can do with a museum where you need to have a chronological approach, for instance. The system of the Mönchengladbach Museum is basically a matrix, not a linear approach, not an enfilade or something like that. So the situation of modern art first half of the century, and at the same time you have neoplasticism, you have surrealism, for instance, at the same time. So in this museum, like in this period, you can go from neoplasticism to the surrealism. You don't have to walk through five rooms of neoplasticism and then you come to surrealism. There are certain museums, of course, where you have to, or you want to have a chronological path. Now, again, I think in art you can really start at every level. You don't have to start the Stone Age in order to understand Michelangelo or Raphael. You can have a direct encounter with a work of art immediately. Of course, if you want to penetrate in depth, it helps if you have a little more knowledge about other periods. I designed a museum of energy, and here we overlay a three-dimensional circular matrix with a linear approach, because in the museum of energy you have to learn certain things. You can only go to step B or C if you have gone through step A. If you don't know the second law of thermodynamics, or you haven't gotten it explained in this museum, if you don't know the basic idea about gravity or so, you will not understand other things. So it is important that you go from one to two to three to four, and then you can spread out. But this is a museum of a different nature. The same can you can do, of course, you can have in an art museum when you maybe want to know about, Chinese sculpture, so you may have to get some information also before to get more initiated. But basically, of course, I had in mind the works of art, and I knew how this, I knew many of the artists, I knew in what way, I knew the artist's studios, which is, I think, very important. That's all the base about lighting. In Mönchengladbach here we have, for instance, some pop-art. Pop-art has been done under artificial lighting under these fluorescent fixtures. And so it's absolutely unnecessary to have curatorial demands about
daylight in terms you have with the impressionists, which of course have been painted in daylight, where you haven't have to have this demands. So I think this background is also very important, and of course this is has been taken into consideration.
Mr. Bolland has been very kind to sit in the spotlight for 2 hours.
I don't mind.
There's a reception in the graduate annex, I believe. No? Right outside, right here. Right here, in this room. So if you have any more questions, informal questions, feel free to ask them then. We hope you'll stay for the reception, that you'll come to a lecture tomorrow evening at 8 p.m. in Royce Hall at UCLA. Stop me if I'm wrong. And I'd like to thank Mr. Holland.
Thank you.